Hello and welcome back to Switch and Lever. In the beginning, Earth was without form and void. Then a whole bunch of stuff happened, and eventually the CNC was invented. CNC mills are freaking amazing, but unfortunately tend to be very expensive. I mean, what does a modern 57-axis plutonium-powered lightsaber CNC mill cost anyway? An arm and a leg? Is one kidney enough, or do you need to sell both? Even the mid-level CNC mills are still comparatively expensive. But the question is, can you go even cheaper? Yes, yes you can, if you skimp on quality and are up for doing some assembly yourself. I have explored CNC milling in the past, and I wanted to get back to doing more in that field for some time. So when Gearbest reached out recently offering to send me one of their low-cost CNC mills for review, I jumped at the opportunity. Even though I said I won't do reviews of cheap Chinese knockoffs anymore, I hope you will see past that and follow along when I put one of these reasonably cheap CNC mills to the test. Full disclosure though, I was paid nothing for this video, and I gain nothing if you spend any money on the Gearbest website or not. This video is entirely for the review, and I will highlight both the good and the bad points, and ultimately answer the question, would I buy it if I had to put down my own money? Though you're going to have to wait to the end of the video for the answer to that question. The mill in question is the 2020B Mini Engraving Machine PVC Mill Engraver. Wow, that's a mouthful. It's a plastic frame CNC mill, capable of milling foam, wood, plastics, wax, and even softer metals such as aluminum and brass. It comes delivered in a reasonably small, albeit heavy box. While the parts are packed somewhat neatly, most of it is not wrapped or protected from shipping damage, as it's mostly just free-floating inside the box. For some reason, everything in the box feels rather dirty, covered in this fine, oily grit. Not really what I expected when I was opening the box. Some of the parts, as you can see, are already pre-assembled, like some parts have not already fitted, and the linear bearings have already been press-fit into some of the plastic pieces. Don't forget all the sale advertisements. Who wouldn't like 1.2 kilos of gold cake? Whatever that is. It's probably only usable in Shenzhen, China though. Maybe next time they could ship cake with the mill as well, as a little added benefit to offset all the dirtiness. The electronics comes at least packaged in their own box, but even so, the plastic bags are also dirty. I don't really understand what could have caused this. While I don't really expect clean room handling, it's still as if this was packed by a car mechanic after he's been working on replacing oil pans all day long. Also, I'm not sure if I should be worried that the power supply warranty seal came pre-broken. Hopefully we'll be fine. The software to control the CNC mill comes on this burnt DVD-R, which I suggest you immediately get rid of once you copy over the contents to a USB flash drive. Who even uses disk-based media anymore? On the disk there's also a bunch of PDF and doc files, which I suggest you print out as they will be needed during the assembly. The assembly of the CNC mill is in itself fairly uncomplicated, and even though the assembly instructions contains a lot of text, it's obviously Google translated Chinese of the worst kind, and most of it makes zero sense. Luckily enough, the pictures are for the most part enough to understand how everything goes together, even though I managed to put a few things on backwards which needed to be taken apart and reassembled. One thing I did not expect though was breaking one of the very first parts I assembled. The plastic which the frame of the mill is made from is extremely stiff, but also extremely brittle. I over-tightened a pair of bolts and I snapped a piece in two. Unfortunately, there was no other way out of that than to make a new piece, which I ended up fabricating out of aluminum. If you get this mill, it's something to be aware of though, as if you break something there's really no going back, and the English instructions really don't warn for this either. The lead screws are just regular threaded rod, and the piece I broke was part of an anti-backlash mechanism. The lead screws could probably do with a bit of straightening as well. While they're reasonably straight, anything but perfect will have negative impacts on the machine operation. Ideally, I would want to replace the lead screws with Acme thread screws instead, for somewhat smoother operation and faster movement. The table that comes with the machine is also made from the same brittle plastic, and since I already broke a piece, I did not quite trust the table to do what I wanted. Instead, I found some scrap aluminum extrusions with slots which can accommodate screws so things can be tightened down more securely to the table. At least when machining metal, you really want your material as rigid as humanly possible. While the table turned out a little heavier than the original table, the machine seems to operate just fine anyway. However, due to the increased height, I'm losing about 30mm of machining height, leaving only about 40mm of height. Since I don't plan on using this machine for very tall objects, that's just fine with me, but again, something to be aware of if you're planning on getting this yourself. At least, the least dramatic thing to assemble was the spindle, which slid in without any issues at all. Though, with some hesitation how tight it should be fastened due to the earlier plastic breakage. With all the moving parts assembled and all the easy stuff out of the way, let's move on to the slightly more complicated electronics. First things first, if you're uncomfortable playing around with AC power, do not build this mill. Connecting the electronics will require you to strip 110 or 220 volt cables to power both the power supply and the transformer for the spindle. Annoyingly, no such cables are supplied in the box, so you have to provide your own. Since there is no obvious place to put the electronics for the mill, I ended up building a box for the mill to sit on, with space underneath for the electronics, spending some time to plan out how to place the individual components most logically, and then screw down to a scrap board which slides into the box. The cables provided for the NEMA 17 stepper motors are just too short to reach the electronics, any way you put them. So you will need to extend those cables with new cables. I simply soldered on a piece of ribbon cable and connected them to screw sockets that fit into the stepper driver board. The same thing unfortunately goes for the spindle motor, but as it carries more current, make sure you use thicker cables. But instead of soldering these on, I connected the extension cables with screw terminals. With many of these connections, especially with the power supply, transformer and the rectifier, adding spade connectors to the cables is a really good idea, rather than just the bare wires. Even though crimping them in should technically be enough, I would still recommend adding a bit of solder to further secure them in place. It never hurts to be doubly secure when playing around with high voltage. It's also a good idea to start up each component one after another to make sure everything works properly, instead of putting everything together and not knowing where the error is if something is not working. All of these issues, non-existing cables, too short, no obvious place to put electronics, exposed wires, yada yada yada, almost makes me believe that the electronics were an afterthought. I fully understand that small mistakes can be made, but with so many of them, there just doesn't seem to be any real reasoning behind it. Since the instructions were somewhat lacking, a multimeter can come in quite handy as well, to figure out which connectors to use to get the right voltage out of the transformer to power the spindle. The instructions that came with the mill was not correct compared to the actual measured voltages. I was truly hoping not to have to use any hot glue in this build, but unfortunately there was one piece where it was simply the right choice. All components, even the rectifier, could be screwed directly into the board, but the relay that turns on and off the spindle simply did not have any mounts, so hot glue was the way out. This CNC mill uses ER11 collets to hold the tools, which coincidentally is the second smallest ER collet available on the market. While the mill ships with a collet which holds a 1/8-inch tool, it will readily accommodate a 3mm tool as well. Since the machine doesn't have a Z depth sensor, you're going to have to set the Z0 manually. and design your CAM programs accordingly. Alright, to the point you've no doubt been waiting for. Can it mill? The software that the mill ships with is fairly self-explanatory if you've done any CNC and CAM work before. It's probably not something you would find easy if you have no experience before, or at least haven't spent some time educating yourself how CAM systems work, what G-code is, and how to operate a CNC mill. Bear in mind that the mill will need to be calibrated using the supplied software as well, so don't expect it to work and be accurate right out of the box. I generated all the G-code needed from Autodesk Fusion 360, and therefore chose the iconic Fusion F to do my tests with. The first test, beyond basic movements, was done in a somewhat soft modeling foam, and as you can see, it's not really giving the intended results. This is partially down to me being too optimistic and taking too deep cuts, and partially the stepper motor skipping steps and cutting where it's not supposed to. Due to that, the mill crashed into the workpiece and knocked it loose from the double-sided sticky tape. The likely reasons behind this was operator error, being a bit too gung-ho with the depth of cut, as well as using a bit too high feed rate. So let's correct those and try again. The second attempt already looked a lot better, but eventually similar errors started showing up, where the motor skipped steps and started milling where it shouldn't. I noticed a lot of squeaking while milling though, which was coming from the lead screws and the nuts which are riding on them. Therefore, all the lead screws and the linear rails and bearings were oiled up with sewing machine oil, which is a light oil which should easily creep in where it's needed without gumming up the works. Lo and behold, even though I didn't manage to get any footage of it, forgot to hit record. Though, the third attempt was far more successful with smooth surfaces and seemingly accurate dimensions. Now, I know what you're going to ask. What about metal? Can it mill metal? Show it milling metal! Okay. Hold on to your horses. Here we go. Milling a small brass Fusion F at slow feed rate with hardly any depth of cut. And, well, judge for yourself. It's not doing too good of a job, I'm afraid. I'm sure it could engrave metal just fine with a very small tool engagement, but using this ball-ended end mill seems like it simply was too much. Even though the plastic the frame is made from is very stiff, it simply isn't stiff enough, and the frame bends ever so slightly, which causes the tool to ride more on the surface of the brass rather than cutting into it. After a few minutes of this torture, I simply had to turn it off. However, if you look close enough, you can kind of make out the Fusion F. So in the end, the question still remains. Would I buy this CNC mill if I had to open up my own wallet? And the answer is... possibly. It's really not so clear-cut. It's reasonably cheap, coming in at around $400, so even with the downsides, it may be at a price point which could justify it. Considering that you could use it as a platform to learn CNC, especially coupled with Fusion 360, it could be seen as a rather attractive little mill. It will require a fair amount of tinkering to get working though, and being somewhat comfortable with electronics. But once you get it running, it is pretty capable. I even ended up writing a small program which will convert a photo into G-code to be used with a homemade pen holder for the mill. It may not be Leonardo da Vinci, but it is at least fun to build a ridiculously overcomplicated printer. In conclusion, get it if you want something to tinker with, but don't get it if you're looking for a production machine. Though, because it is so simple, it could easily be used as a start for building your own CNC mill, for instance replacing the plastic parts with aluminum plate. I don't really know if it would be cheaper than buying the parts separately, but it is at least something worth exploring. If you're interested in looking closer at this CNC mill, look at the links in the description. I really hope you enjoy this video, and while you're waiting for your own Mona Lisa portrait, why don't you take a look at one of the other videos from Switch and Lever. And also remember to head over to Instagram for more non-sequitur material. Until next time!